my two favorite things in the entire universe, which is games and museums. And we're going to talk about why museums need you and why you need museums. So, I'm going to start by telling you a story. Once upon a time, in a land far, far away, almost like Pittsburgh. So, late at night, with a group of people, I went to a very large building. Everything was closed. It was dark. We were alone. We were ushered in to a dark room where we were asked a series of questions about what we were afraid of, about what we liked and what we thought about. We were separated into groups. I was in a group of six, and each of us was handed a single object. I was handed a bone. Someone else was handed an egg. A third person was handed a feather. And then they put us in this silent freight elevator. The six of us, where it said, "Silence, please." And we slowly shook up to the second floor in the freight elevator. The doors opened. And the six of us standing there with our objects opened into this massive dark gallery. There was nothing there. There was nobody there except for the pieces of art. And we had been instructed to be silent. And there were these sort of lights that led the way. And so there we are with our object, just all the way through the gallery in these long lines with these shapes of modern art just sort of hulking around us. A way that you never see modern art, right? Silent, in the dark, full of shadows, like pure magic. So as we turn the corner, clunk, 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 we see a gigantic sort of pillar with an Asian Buddha on the top of it, all lit up in purple light. And at the very bottom is this girl. Actually, we're still there. The very bottom is a girl. She is holding a bell, right? And so she rings the bell. The space is so big. It's so dark and it's so silent. It's hard for me to explain how large this place is. And so we saw her, and she's far away. And we didn't have to stay in the line, but we did. So we were walking towards her in this line, following the light until we get to her. And when we get to her, she starts speaking about philosophy and life and death and Buddha and everything in between. And then she separates us. And individually, we all follow our own pathways, five different colors, as we clomp now alone through this big open space. And I followed this one simple square of light until I hit this. There's nothing, right? Just this big open room, one single square of light. And in that single square of light, just for me, is this beautiful piece of art. Nothing else is lit but this. And I stand in my square and I look at this piece of art. Now, I could describe this piece of art to you up, down, and backwards. I felt so deeply connected to the colors and the shapes and just the oppression of the whole thing, just the sense of it sort of weighing down on you. For 5 minutes, I stood in that square of light, staring at this one beautiful piece of art that is so American. It's so Pittsburgh. It's so depression, right? It's so full of our history of racism and classism and economic struggle. And so I found afterwards that this piece of art was by Samuel Rosenberg Greenfield Hill, and it is at the Carnegie Museum of Art. Because that's where I was. I was at the Carnegie Museum, and I was experiencing a production called Dodo, which I think is probably the best production I've ever seen in my life. And the idea of Dodo was it was about life and death and everything in between. It was about decay and permanence and everything in between, and how we as humans interact with those things and relate with them. And the thing that's so special about museums, the thing that makes museums different from any other place in the world, is how deeply they believe in magic and the magic of objects, and why objects are imbued with a certain human magic that matters. They believe so much in this magic that they are willing to spend years and years of their lives being way overeducated and way underpaid in order to preserve these objects, because they think these objects mean something. So, the thing that was really cool about this particular interactive was it wasn't just sort of a puzzle hunt, and it wasn't just a LARP, and it wasn't just a walkthrough. It was a little bit of everything, which I think is so important. Museums think a lot about this because they have to deal with a lot of different types of people who have a lot of different facilities and barriers to entry. And so there were a lot of ways that I could interact with this. The actors were fantastic. I had all of these people that played these different characters. I also had museum professionals. This guy, he played one of the museum founders. I was just sort of walking through this back alley, and they were like, oh, go talk to so-and-so. I don't remember his name. And they opened the door, and I'm in a hallway. And it was sort of this part of the museum that had been abandoned. Obviously, they had built over it or something. And he was just smoking a cigarette, telling me about how he founded the museum. Such an incredible experience, that sense of the humanity at the beginning of these places that are so distant sometimes. And there were also actual museum professionals, which was so exciting. At one point, I walked through a door, and I'm in an office. So this is like a standard museum office. There's like lots of boxes with decommissioned dead animals around, right? And like lots of paperwork. And there's this one table, sort of a ways back. There's a light, and there's a guy. And I go up closer to him. I mean, this was totally a theme. We were at the Carnegie Museum is so huge, and they had us in these groups of six, so often we were alone or in ones or twos, and so we sort of clump up to this guy. He is taxidermying a bird. Right there in front of me, I'd never seen something like that so close before. He's a museum taxidermist, and he's showing me, like, this is how we take the bodies of animals that people give us, and this is how we preserve them. And right now, I'm taking arsenic so that we can kill any of the bugs or bacteria that's in there. And he's like, he's pulling the skin aside, this little beautiful little songbird. And he explains to us about how most of these birds that they have right now, they break their nests flying into buildings, and then people donate them to the museum. And then they took this into the back stacks, where he opened up this great big drawer full of snowy owls, must have 100 snowy owls. And he just talked about how the reason they collect so many is so they could have a record of the variation, because there are so many different types of snowy owls. And of course, you know, these are all things that were collected 100, 200 years ago. This is the Carnegie Museum. So, you know, back in the day, they did not necessarily have the value of snowy owls that we did. I got to go up into the rafters of this building where these two wonderful people played birds and they sang to us. It was so incredible. And this experience of just exploring, right? So there was a lot of walking through spaces. And I got to talk to the taxidermist. Other people got to talk to the mollusk specialist. So there were also people in the mollusks area where they didn't just bring you through all the spaces with birds. They also brought you through the spaces that had shellfish and mollusks and just all of this wonderful, magical stuff that was hanging out in this museum. Here are all the birds. I mean, like, if you haven't been in the back of museum stacks, it's amazing. I work with museums, love museums with my whole heart. They have stacks and stacks and stacks of these animals you just never see, right? And it's so incredible as an experience, and as an immersive experience, to see what's back there. They finished it with the most permanent thing that we know, gemstones, which was so fascinating because it was all about destruction, decay, death, the impermanence of life. And then they're like, oh, by the way, we know something that's lasted a couple of million years. And here they are. And I had never really thought about gems in that sense before, that sense of minerals, things that we touch and see every day that they've lasted such a long time. Oh God, I told you that story, and now I've got 5 minutes to tell you the rest, so, oh God. All right, moral of the story. Museums really want this stuff. I was there for a conference, and the museums were just blown away and so excited about what was happening. H.G. Darling's incredible museum in Baltimore a gorgeous immersive piece at the Peel Center that talks about collection. The People's Revolt is another immersive piece that has happened at the Tower of London. Extremely popular, completely new way to see that space. They made it into a spy mystery. Waiting Rooms, really interesting game about bureaucracy. Started at the Rubin Museum in New York, went to the Boston Museum of Science, Red House, used the entire Houston Museum District. So you don't necessarily need to just use one museum, you can use all of them. And there's so many of these. Game Kitchen has weekly games at the Victoria and Albert Museum. Montreal Museums, they have an actual exhibit on LARPs because museums are so interested in this way of engaging right now. Hey, Lizzie is writing about running nanolarps for the Peabody Essex Museum. Peabody Essex just ran an exhibit on play where they were extremely interested in what's happening with LARPs. So Why We Play is an exhibit at the Smithsonian, which is all about Nordic LARPs. Briefly, who am I? I build games. And I build games at museums whenever possible. So look me up. Green Door Labs is the name of my company. You can always find me online. But back to museums. So briefly, museums at a glance, right? Nobody goes into museums for the money. Money, they have none of it, right? But they've got a lot of heart. What they do have is space. They have space, some of the best spaces in the world. In fact, specifically, if you have the best space in the world, you make it into a museum. Again, they're people who believe in magic, who believe in magic spaces, who preserve these beautiful, incredible magic spaces. Originally, museums were called Wunderkammers. They were cabinets of wonder. These are people who made it their entire purpose to build magic into spaces. What do they care about? A lot of people think that museums care about ticket sales. That is not true. Every visitor is extremely expensive for a museum, and museums do not usually survive off of their ticket sales. Only 27% of funding for museums is earned funding. And so if you go to a museum and you say to them, we will get more people through your doors, they know that you do not know anything about them or their business model. Median annual wages of museum occupations. I just want you to know who you're dealing with, right? These are fellow artists. These are fellow educators who suffer for their cause. A lot of people go into museums thinking like, oh yeah, well museums, they have tons of money. That's not true. The people that you're dealing with are also people who are overeducated and underpaid, but they love what they do. So what can museums, what do museums want? Do they want status? No, they don't care, right? They have status. That doesn't matter to them. They want engagement, right? They don't care about the numbers. They don't care about the money. They don't care about the status. What they care about is engagement, right? They want the best possible experience for everybody who goes into these places. They want to help other people understand why these objects matter. Right? Why is this magic? How can you see that this is magic? They want to increase empathy, right? There are so many studies that say that engaging with museums really does help you to increase empathy. And they also want to reach underserved populations. There is this unfortunate impression of museums that they are sort of these very distant spaces, which is fascinating because I see how much museums suffer trying to reach out to these underserved populations, like, oh, if only we could reach, you know, X or Y. Like, they really want to reach out to these places. So, engagement. Hey, what does engagement? Here's Armistice Arcane. These guys, they look pretty engaged. How about increasing some empathy? These guys look pretty empathetic. Like, look at these guys. They look like wealthy white people, but maybe they're talking about immigration and the troubles that they're having in other countries. Reaching underserved populations, hey! This is a very underserved population. They look pretty reached out to, right? So, do you know anybody at all, for the love of God, who could possibly create memorable experiences? Who could increase empathy? Who could reach underserved populations? Like, maybe autism? autistic children. Like, who could do that? I have no idea. Maybe it's you. This is why you need to think about why museums need you and why you have something that is so valuable for these magical spaces. So, in the 2 seconds that I have, how to reach out to museums, because I hope that all of you reach out to museums thinking about how what you do can impact what they do and how these partnerships can just make the world such a much better place. First, be known, be trustworthy, meet your museum's community, don't be a stranger, right? Volunteer, go there, be a member, talk to them, right? Don't just show up as a total stranger and be like, hey, I've never seen this place before, but it looks cool. Reach out to museum educators. Educators are the people you want to talk to. That's your lowest barrier to entry. Don't talk to your curators. Don't talk to your marketers. Don't talk to anybody on the board. Talk to the educators. That's who cares about what we do. Come armed with your resources. Again, everybody here, unpaid, overworked, right? So they don't have an awful lot of time. So don't come to them with a sort of hand-wavy, like, well, I was thinking, you know, if we just kind of worked together, they'd be like, great, I have no time to figure out how to do this. Come armed saying, I have this, this, and this. What if we did something on this date? This is what it would look like. Have a plan ready. Be aware of staff and budget restrictions. There will be a lot of them, right? You can build something. You might not be able to build exactly the thing that you're thinking of, but something can be built without a doubt. So be flexible and figure out what it is that can be built within those design parameters. Be flexible, be patient. These places move slow. So, like, they've got nothing but time. As they like to say, we're in the forever business. All right, so the takeaways. Museums are here. They have magic spaces. They care about what we're doing. We have a lot to offer the museum's community. So please, build, play, engage, explore. These two communities really, really should be resources for one another. Here's a couple things if you want to check them out. Museums in the Web will happen in Boston. They specifically want to focus on immersion, immersive theater, games, LARPs, interactives. Like, they came to me, like, I'm just a contractor, and they were like, can you help us co-chair this? Because we want you to help reach out to the games community to bring them to us. That's really something, right? I mean, like, these sort of, like, very distant museums would actually seek out a game designer and be like, please bring your people to us. Everett Region has a regional museums organization. Who's from New England? Who here is from New England? Okay, about half you guys are from New England. NEMA is our regional museums organization. They're gonna have a yearly conference. They usually have monthly events. If you're not from New England, your region also has a museums organization. Check these people out. They really wanna meet you. Questions, ideas, email me anytime at Green Door Labs, kellyanne@greendoorlabs.com. I am so sad to say that I cannot stay for the conference. I had an engagement in New York, so I'm leaving like literally like 10 minutes from now. However, I'm so excited that Dowd is here. This is Dowd Alazar from the State House Museum, or formerly of the State House Museum, who knows everything there is to know about New England museums, immersion, engagement, LARPing, and interaction. So please talk to Dowd. You'll be my proxy. So, and if you do nothing else, go to a museum and think about what you can build there. So,